Thank you. So this is work that we've been doing at Uppsala, but also in cooperation with people from University of Murcia and NTNU Norway. So I assume everyone pretty much knows about speculative execution, but very quickly, what happens in a high-performance core is you try to execute all available instructions. And sometimes that means that you have an instruction that might take a long time to execute, like this red instruction here, and then you just speculatively execute more instructions hoping that you're doing the correct thing. And the idea is that if something goes wrong, then you delete or squash all the other instructions and you restart from the beginning. The problem is that when you do this squashing, you eliminate any visible side effects of the instruction, such as, you know, writing to registers and stuff like that, but not the invisible side effects, for example, changes to the caches. So this is a problem because attacks like Spectre and Meltdown have surfaced exactly because of this. So the idea is that you can use this speculative execution. You make some changes to the caches with code that normally wouldn't be executed because it's not correct code, it's not, maybe it's insecure code. And then you can observe these changes later. And one of the ways to do it, for example, with Meltdown is that you can have some data you want to leak. You use the data as part of a memory access, and you specifically use the data as part of the address of the memory access. So then you can go in the cache, look where you have data in the cache, and then infer that secret data. And these are two very well-known attacks, but since this has been released, a lot of new attacks have also been released with different kinds of the system. So I think there's been one every month, maybe. So our idea is simple. Speculative execution is leaking information because it updates part of the system. So for example, you install an evict cache lines, you update the TLB, and all this kind of stuff. So what if you don't do this stuff? What happens? And can you do that in an efficient way, of course? And for this work that I'm going to present, we focus specifically on the caches and on load accesses. And what I'm going to talk about is not just for Spectre and Meltdown, but it's essentially for all speculative execution. So any attack that depends on this shouldn't be able to work. Again, on the caches and load accesses. So first things first, we have the baseline, which is the red line. And this is a normal out-of-order core. So first question is, what happens if we don't do speculative execution at all? What if we just take the loads, delay them until they're no longer speculative, until we're sure they're going to be executed and they will have side effects, and then we should be safe? So the problem with this is, even though it should be safe, you lose about 40% of performance and there is a 30% energy increase in the core. So this is not really a great solution, obviously. So the next idea is invisible speculation. So what if with all speculative loads, we do them without any side effects to the degree that is possible, of course, since you always need to keep a small amount of state. So for example, you don't update any the caches, you don't even update the LRU, you don't update the TLBs, you don't do any coherence, and you only allow very specific updates to very small structures, like for example, you need MSHR entry still. And even if you do prefetching triggered by these accesses, you keep them also hidden by the same ghost accesses. So it turns out that this is even worse than not doing a speculation at all, because essentially what we're doing is we're disabling caching for a very large percentage of the accesses of an application. So the performance is, to put it nicely, terrible. And we've observed that for some applications, you increase the DRAM axis quite a lot, and on average, this is like 18x, not percent, but x, 18 times more memory accesses. So also not great. So how can we optimize this? So one idea is to bring back a small cache, since, you know, every time we want to optimize something in computer architecture, we add a small cache. And the idea is that this is a cache only for these ghost accesses, the speculative loads that we're not sure if they're safe or not. It's very small, it's 8 entries, for the L1. It's read-only, since we only care about loads. And we have to take extra care that we not enable any attacks on that cache also. So we have to make it fully associative, maybe, if possible, randomize the accesses, and a lot of other stuff which I don't have time to talk about, but we can talk later. And the idea is that you have one of these small caches for every normal cache, And there you store normal, you store ghost accesses, so speculative loads, and also any prefetching triggered by speculative loads in that cache. And the results are kind of better than delay, but you know, still 40% performance loss is not exactly great. So the next idea is something we call materialization. And essentially the idea is you do your ghost access, which is invisible to the system, and then when you know it's safe, why not just do the side effects then? So then, when it's safe, you can update the cache, update the LRU, maybe use the ghost buffer that we mentioned before. If there's data there, why not bring them in the cache, and so on. And again, performance improves over the base, you know, do everything delay or do everything, all speculation, hide everything, but it's still not quite there. So finally, the solution we have right now is a combination of all three. The idea is that when you do a ghost access, a speculative load, you put it in a ghost buffer. The data you bring, you put them in a small ghost buffer. And then when you know that the data is safe, then you do this materialization, and you can bring the data either from the ghost buffer or from the memory if they're not there, depending on what you want to do. And for this, we end up getting around 12% performance loss and 8% energy increase in the core. We believe that the main reason for the performance loss is probably MLP, since you cannot really coalesce speculative and normal accesses for security reasons. They go to different caches and so on. And yes, still 12% might not be, doesn't sound great, but compared to other solutions, it's, for example, compiler solutions have seen down to 30% performance loss and stuff like that. So for the cost of security, it's not really that big, especially compared to other solutions. So these are the full results that we have. And of course, there's lots of numbers, so don't really pay attention to all of them. But something interesting is there are a few cases where delaying speculative loads until they're no longer speculative is actually better than the alternatives we talked about. And we haven't really investigated this in detail, but it could be that there is a balance between that we can achieve. So you do some speculative, you do some that you delay, or maybe you delay for a small amount of time and then you do speculative. And again, open question, we don't really know what it is. But yeah, this is essentially the 12% I talked about over almost all of the spec benchmarks. And of course, performance is not everything. We also care about energy. And these energy numbers are for MACPAT, so you know, take them with a grain of salt, obviously. But we see that we have some energy we waste if we do the solution with the ghost buffer and the materialization, but the alternative solutions are quite worse. For example, this purple line, which is the ghosts, where we just make everything invisible, which someone could argue is the most secure solution also, it's 2.3 times less energy efficient. And there is one benchmark that goes to 11x. And the reason is that this benchmark has 600 more times DRAM accesses when you do ghosts than the baseline, which I wasn't even sure that was possible. So to conclude with, speculative execution leaks a lot of information. So can we prevent that? And how much does this cost? So we have a solution, which is make accesses as invisible as possible, keep any data that they bring in a small cache that's secured with additional methods. And then when we know it's fine, when we know this is no longer speculative access, when it's time to commit, then you can essentially replay the side effects with what we call materialization. And then you can get security for a lot of speculative attacks with a 12% performance cost and 8% energy cost. There's a lot of stuff to do, of course. For example, question is, do we actually need to secure all loads? Are all data equally important? Maybe there's some data nobody cares about. Maybe it's known data. So also, there has to be more ways to improve performance because this is just a quick solution. And surely we can optimize it more. And then, as I mentioned earlier, what about delay versus ghosts? Can we do some solution where we use both? Can we predict which one is better for which application, for which phase of the application? And at the same time, what about when we do materialization, which is when we replay the side effects of the instruction? Do we actually need to do that all the time? Because as it turns out, a lot of the time when we do that, the data is already in the cache, brought in by a different access that was not speculative, since it takes some time from an instruction to actually be executed and then be committed and then do the whole thing. And that's all.
Thank you, Christos. So we are now open for questions from the floor.
Hi. So when you replay during the commit stage, do you load the data from the buffer to cache? And or you can get it from the main memory to the cache, right? So if you do that, then you are still experiencing different latency to install that data in the cache at the commit side, which might reveal some information. And if you choose not to get to memory to do that, then some of the data will not be in the cache after certain like commits, which will again leak some information to the outside world.
Mm-hmm. So there's two things. First of all, when we do materialization at commit, it's not an operation you have to wait for. You just send a packet to the cache, and then you do a commit. Because you don't need that for correctness, you only need it for performance. And then, as you said, yes, you can introduce some extra timing that you can take advantage of. So I have a number of things, for example, which I don't really have time to talk about, but the idea is, for example, you can do stuff like if you have a mispeculation and you need to squash your state, then you also flush the buffer, which means that if you have a mispeculation, you cannot really take advantage of a mispeculation and then go and read what have you actually brought in the cache and stuff like that. But it's impossible to have a solution that has zero leakage unless you have something like a fully, at least we cannot think of a solution that has exactly zero leakage, because there's so much stuff you can have timing for. Stuff even that are not targeted to specific addresses, but you can do congestion attacks and all this kind of stuff. So this is more of a trade-off. Okay, maybe there are some side, you know, cases where maybe you can leak some stuff, but, you know, I don't know if that answers the question.
Yeah, I have a question about two separate questions. But first, if you have a chain of dependent accesses and the first one is speculative, it seems like they would all go to the ghost buffer. And in the end, you would just have everything going to the ghost buffer in the worst case. Can you talk a little bit more about how you separate out ghost accesses from non-ghost accesses?
Yeah, so there is something called lipastic conditions, which essentially say when an application, instruction is safe to commit or not, and we kind of use this. The idea is that there is something in front of you that might cause a squash in the pipeline, then you have to be speculative. Otherwise, it's fine. And with some small cases where you have to be extra careful about loads being speculative anyway, because you know you do TLB access and everything, and some of these details. So what you say is actually true, and we get quite a large percentage of accesses being speculative. And yes, I'm not sure if there is a solution for that, but yes, one access can make the whole, all the instructions you have in your reorder buffer, I guess, be speculative after that, and so on. But the good thing is that if you manage to execute some of these, and then the first access that causes the delay is resolved and it's committed, then the rest don't have to be speculative anymore.
Okay, and how do you size your ghost buffer?
Is just a normal ghost buffer. We haven't changed any of that stuff. Because we don't actually delay anything from being executed or other than the performance cost we get anyway, but we don't delay anything in the ghost buffer. So the size of the ghost buffer, load store queues, and all this stuff is the same as in the baseline. So 192, I think, for this evaluation. Yes. Oh, sorry, the ghost buffer, sorry. The ghost buffer, it was kind of, we don't really have a smart way. 8 entries seem to be enough. It's small enough that it's not very expensive. You can also do some optimizations. I guess it depends on your workloads, like everything else when it comes to caching. And we have 8 entries for the L1, and then for the L2 we have I think half a kilobyte. No, that doesn't make sense. We have as big L2 field buffer as the L2 is bigger than the L1. If that answers the question. But it's not really, we didn't do anything smart. It was, okay, this works and it's small enough. Like any other cast, right?
Okay, so I have a couple of questions. So what if there is the overflow from the coarse buffer?
Overflow, it's we treat it like a normal cast, so you do a replacement. And then you lose the data. And when you do replay, you have to bring it from memory if you want.
Okay, and second question is the for L2 and L3, like from the coarse buffer to, let's say, materialization, like are you going to send the message after like every single instruction commit or something?
Yeah, so we're doing that now. It's not optimal. So one of my last point, the predictor, most of them we don't need to send. And we're wasting a lot of traffic and cache congestion that way. But from some benchmarks we run, it doesn't seem like it affects too much. But we can really optimize that by checking if we actually need to do materialization or not. Because as I mentioned, a lot of the time, by the time we end up doing materialization, the data is already there. So there's no point.
But predictor seems quite risky. I mean, for like spectre like malicious attacks, they maybe manipulate the excess pattern so that like predictor can be kind of dumb enough so that the attackers can bypass that, so that they can exploit this security weakness from the cache coherence side channel or some others.
But the thing is, first of all, cache coherence we've never really talked about, but the thing is the ghosts are for security, materialization is for performance. So you can do no materialization at all and you will still be correct. It's only for extra performance. So if you have a predictor and it predicts something wrong, it's fine. And then if the data have not been accessed, so the idea is not to predict what we should materialize, if we should do materialization or not. So by the time we do materialization, the instruction will be at the commit stage. We'll know it's safe to access the data, otherwise it would have a fault already. And then the question is, should we actually do the materialization or not? So even if you somehow manage to train the predictor to do something malicious, it's not going to do anything that normal access wouldn't do anyway, outside of speculation.
But it changes the cache state, right?
Yes, but this is outside of speculation, when you know that the access is safe now.
Where it left a different footprint. In the normal case, you would actually have that in the cache, and here you can change, train a predictor to not have that in the cache.
Yes, that's true. Yes, and there are, again, there are some small footprints here and there. I'm not sure there is a solution that you can leave zero footprint. And, I mean, this is just one part of the system, right? Because then you also have memories. There is an attack that targets the AVX execution because it takes time to ramp up, and apparently the worm is speculative or used to, and stuff like that. So, again, I'm not an expert in security, but I feel like it's almost impossible to do 100% speculative execution and 100% invisible and also get the performance we want from modern processors. So it's, again, it's a trade-off. We limit the footprint and we limit the exposure to speculative execution as much as possible, but we cannot have 0% footprint.
Could you tell us a bit about how the ghost loads interact with the coherence state itself? So if you have shared cache lines upon which you've performed a ghost access, which is exclusive in another cache, and
Of work in progress, so we don't really have a complete solution. There is some work with Stefanos, who's sitting next to you, is working with Alberto. They have some work on what they are allowed to do, and also sometimes you can delay some other. They have some recent work where you can delay other instructions potentially, but I'm not one. I cannot really answer your question in detail.
Thanks for all the questions, and let's thank our speaker again, Christos.